A young boy and his father are standing together in a room. Between them sits a helmet. This is the helmet of a Roman soldier. I took this helmet from my greatest enemies in war, the father says to his son. As he looks at the helmet, he can almost imagine a pair of eyes looking at him through the holes, offering yet another challenge. But he will not be there to fight the Romans again. He's too old. Others will have to do what must be done. They will be your greatest enemies too, the father says softly. His son, eyes fixed on the helmet, betrays no emotion and says nothing. Swear to make yourself an enemy of Rome until the day you die. I swear. In the ancient Mediterranean, Carthage and Rome were the two greatest powers. Carthage was older, founded by Phoenician traders in the 800s BCE on the African coast. Its position along Mediterranean trade routes quickly made it one of the most prosperous cities in the region. Its population expanded, it traded on a large scale, and it colonized islands in the Mediterranean. By 300 BCE, Carthage controlled much of North Africa west of Egypt and had a monopoly over the western Mediterranean. Rome, on the other hand, was newer to the great power game. It only turned its focus to a broader world after it successfully unified Italy in the mid-200s BCE. By that time, Rome, still ruled by a republican government, began taking an interest in the island of Sicily, which was also desired by the Carthaginians. These tensions came to a boiling point in 264 BCE, resulting in the First Punic War. The father in the first scene was a man named Hamilcar Barca. He was a general of the Carthaginian military. His life and career were dominated by fighting against the rising power of Rome. He ultimately ended up losing his war, but in the process he gained an eternal hatred for the Romans. Despite early successes by the Carthaginians in this war, mostly because of their naval power, the Romans quickly adapted, building a powerful navy of their own and dominating on land and on sea. Soon, Sicily was lost, and the Carthaginian government sought peace in 241. In the aftermath, Carthage failed to pay its mercenaries and experienced a serious revolt. The Romans took the opportunity to take control of Corsica and Sardinia, a further humiliation. Hamilcar, having put down the revolt of the mercenaries, was intensely dissatisfied with Carthage. He led an expedition to Spain in 237. He established a Carthaginian foothold in Spain and settled some colonies, making a new life in a new land. It was here that Hamilcar brought out an old Roman helmet for his son, one that he had taken in battle long ago. It was here that Hamilcar made his son swear to always be an enemy of Rome. His son's name was Hannibal. BCE. After two decades of peace, war is brewing. Hannibal Barca is the commander of the Carthaginian army in Spain. He has helped consolidate Carthaginian control there over the past years, securing the silver mines and founding new cities. His mercenary armies are strengthened by local recruits. The armies are diverse, composed of Gauls, Celts, Iberians, and North Africans. His intention is to follow through on his oath to his father. Hannibal marched on the Roman allied city of Saguntum in 219 BCE. There was a dispute over the borders set by a treaty, and Saguntum was technically within Carthaginian borders. But the city was allied with Rome. Hannibal enforced the Carthaginian view in brutal fashion. Despite Roman complaints, he continued his siege into the next year, eventually sacking the city and killing or enslaving over 15,000 people. Rome could not tolerate this, and they declared war on Carthage. The Second Punic War was on. Hannibal took his army across Spain and Gaul, dodging Roman allies along the coast. After fighting some battles with allied Roman tribes, Hannibal decided to take his army across the Alps and into Italy itself in October of 218. Such a crossing, such a large army, was unheard of, but Hannibal decided it needed to be done. Meanwhile, the Romans were invading Carthaginian Spain with limited success. When Hannibal emerged from the Alps in late 218, the Romans were stunned. They had been preparing for an invasion of North Africa, but they put that on hold to face the more immediate threat. A Roman army was slowly assembled at the Trebia River in northern Italy, with the two armies camping on opposite sides of the river. Hannibal had about 20,000 infantry and 10,000 cavalry with him at the Trebia. The cavalry was mostly drawn from Numidia, a North African state with formidable horsemen. The Romans were more infantry heavy, with about 35,000 infantry and 5,000 cavalry. Hannibal, still waiting on reinforcements from across the Alps, was outnumbered. After some initial engagements, the decisive encounter came on the 22nd of December. In the early morning before dawn, Hannibal ordered his soldiers up to eat an early breakfast. The Numidian cavalry was sent across the shallow Trebia River to harass the Romans. They took the bait. First the Roman cavalry and then the Roman infantry were drawn out of their beds and onto the battlefield. The Numidians fought a slow retreat across the river, draining the Romans, who had not eaten breakfast. The Carthaginians, well rested and with full stomachs, were ready for battle by the time the Romans had made it across the river. Hannibal decided to stretch his line to match the Roman line in length. He could not risk being outflanked, and placed his more numerous cavalry on the flanks to protect against this. The downside was that the thinner Carthaginian line would be easier to break. The battle began. In the center, the Gallic infantry, less experienced and heavily armed, began to give way under the weight of the Roman charge. However, the Carthaginian cavalry on the flanks won decisive victories, putting the Roman horsemen to flight and attacking the Roman flanks. A small detachment of about 2,000 Carthaginian infantry had been sent on a side mission, and it now took the opportunity to swing around the Roman army, attacking its back flank. While the Roman center had great success, the Roman army began collapsing from other angles due to the other attacks. Eventually, the Carthaginians prevailed, breaking the Roman formations and taking many prisoners. Hannibal had now won a decisive victory on Roman territory. Thousands of Gallic recruits flocked to his army. The Romans were terrified, and they sent another army to face him immediately. In early 217, the Romans were surprised to find that Hannibal had pulled off another winter crossing, this time passing the Apennines and reaching deep into central Italy. The Roman consul Gaius Flaminius was in command of a large army near Hannibal's previous position, and realized that the Carthaginians had walked right past him. Hannibal's army, now perhaps 60,000 strong, was ravaging the Italian countryside, looting and burning farms. Embarrassed by the failure to keep Hannibal contained, Flaminius rushed to face Hannibal. He moved so fast that he had no time to send scouts ahead. This left him vulnerable to surprises. A surprise was awaiting the Romans at Lake Trasimene in the summer of 217. Hannibal marched his army along the road that followed the northern shore of the lake. North of this road was a set of hills. His plan was to lure the Romans to follow him along this road, hide soldiers up on the hills, and then attack the Romans from the side during the battle. On the morning of the battle, the Romans rushed the Carthaginian positions at the end of the road following the shore. Most of their army was not in battle formation. The thin road stretched the army out into a long line, and only the front of the Roman column was engaged in combat. The rest of the Romans were just waiting. Suddenly, trumpets sounded from their left flank. This sent them into a panic, but before they could react, an overwhelming force of Gallic, North African, and Spanish soldiers, both infantry and cavalry, hit them from the side. They were not at all prepared for this, and although they fought hard, they were unable to resist the pressure. Most of them either died where they stood or were pushed into the lake, where they drowned. Pretty much every single one out of 30,000 Roman soldiers was either killed or captured in this battle. After this defeat, Rome was even more fearful. It seemed like Hannibal was unstoppable. The Romans decided in the summer of 217 that they needed a dictator. Despite the fact that Rome was a republic, they had an office called dictator, which had total power over all matters of state. However, these dictators only served for periods of 6 months and were appointed only in periods of severe crisis. This was definitely a severe crisis, and the Romans appointed a man named Quintus Fabius Maximus, an experienced Roman statesman, as dictator. Fabius decided that the Romans should adopt a new approach. He ordered the Romans to avoid fighting open battles with Hannibal at all costs. The new idea was to fight a war of attrition against Hannibal, cutting off his supply lines and weakening his army indirectly. This strategy began to take its toll on Hannibal's army, which frequently found itself short on supplies. But the Romans were still impatient and eager for a decisive victory, and Fabius' strategy would take years to produce a result. And so the Senate voted not to reappoint Fabius as dictator. Instead, when 216 came around, they gave the command to the two elected consuls, Varro and Paulus. The Romans decided they needed to win decisively. While Hannibal was making slow progress down the Italian peninsula, eventually making his way to southern Italy, Rome began raising a massive army, the largest army they had ever assembled, to face their greatest enemy yet. The decisive confrontation came in the summer of 216. Rome had brought over 85,000 men to this battle, while the Carthaginians were left with just over 50,000. The battle came on a flat plain near the supply depot and village of Cannae, which Hannibal had seized in the spring. The Romans had picked a flat plain because of Hannibal's use of hills, forests, and rivers to defeat them in previous battles. They would not leave anything to surprise here. Two consuls were with the Roman army, and when two consuls served in command of an army, the practice was for them to alternate supreme command every other day. Paulus was more cautious, calculated, and reluctant to fight Hannibal, but Varro was hot-headed and wanted a challenge. On Paulus's day, the 1st of August, he refused battle, but on the next day, Varro's day, the 2nd of August, he ordered the Romans up at the break of dawn. They formed up for battle. The battle formations were very uneven. The Romans had packed their heavy infantry densely in the center in an attempt to take advantage of their numerical superiority and smash through the Carthaginian lines. Their cavalry was on the wings. Interestingly, the consuls were commanding from the cavalry, one on each flank, meaning they would have trouble communicating with their main army. Hannibal had done the opposite of the Romans. He had placed the Gallic and Spanish forces in a thin line down the center, the North African infantry on the left and right in larger groups, and the cavalry on the flanks. The Carthaginians, despite being outnumbered overall, still outnumbered the Romans in cavalry, a decisive advantage. The two armies charged. The weak center of the Carthaginians immediately began to show. The Carthaginian line buckled inward, and the Romans pushed forward. It seemed like they were winning. Meanwhile, the Numidian cavalry of the Carthaginians was getting the better of the Romans. They were pushing the Roman horsemen back. In the center, the Roman infantry kept pushing forward, and the Carthaginian center kept backing up. but it did not seem to be breaking at any points. In fact, the retreat seemed very calculated, as if something was happening. Turns out the North African infantry on the Carthaginian flanks had not been moving very much, and was instead positioning itself on the Roman flanks as the Roman center extended more and more. The Romans found themselves under assault from the flanks as the North African infantry fanned out and began to surround them. Finally, the hammer on the anvil. The Roman cavalry had been decisively defeated, and the Carthaginian cavalry swept around the back of the Roman army, crashing into its rear flank. The Romans were fully encircled. The following hours until sundown saw a bloodbath. Tens of thousands of Romans were butchered where they stood. As the Carthaginians closed in, the Romans were packed so tight that many of them could not even lift their arms to block their shields or raise their swords. Some of them just buried their heads in the ground like chickens and suffocated themselves to death. Paulus died on the battlefield, while Varro escaped with a small unit of cavalry. By the end of the day, over 70,000 of the Romans were captured and killed. Some have estimated that over the three battles in 2 years against Hannibal, the Romans lost 20% of their adult male population. If Rome was scared before, this was the last straw. The city was thrown into full-blown panic. The Carthaginians were practically at the gates of the city, and the Romans had no armies left in Italy. Many feared that Hannibal's next step was Rome itself, and that their great civilization was finally finished. But Hannibal didn't march on Rome. He had no siege equipment, and without it, there was no way he could penetrate Rome's strong walls. His main focus was to turn Rome's Italian allies against Rome and surround the city with enemies until it finally surrendered. Hannibal spent the next few years not seeking a decisive attack, but fighting a slow political battle with the cities of Italy. Meanwhile in Rome, Fabius was made the dictator once again, as the Romans finally realized the merits of his strategy. He succeeded in keeping Hannibal contained over the next few years, operating from a distance, cutting his supply lines, and taking advantage of their home turf. Fabius also countered Hannibal's political ideas by successfully keeping most of Rome's allies on its side, despite the devastating defeats. Hannibal tried, but it seemed like Rome's allies would live and die with Rome. Carthage was also facing a formidable new enemy, a young man named Scipio. The Scipios were a noble family in Rome, and his father-in-law was Paulus, the consul who had fallen at Cannae. Scipio himself almost died at Cannae, and only barely escaped the encirclement. The young Scipio's father, another Scipio, fell in combat in Spain, and the young Scipio immediately asked to be sent there to command the Roman forces. Despite a bad situation in Spain, Scipio began to turn things around there, winning some victories and capturing the Carthaginian capital in Spain. The final hope for a decisive blow against Rome came in the form of Hannibal's brother, Hasdrubal Barca. He brought a massive army from Spain through the Alps in 208, avoiding Scipio's army and attempting to link up with Hannibal. If they were able to combine their military strength, they would finally be able to march on Rome. Hasdrubal made it into Italy with support from the Gauls, and it seemed like he would be able to meet with his brother. But the Romans had other ideas. A smaller Roman force was facing the Carthaginians, and Hasdrubal was confident of victory. But what he didn't know was that a reinforcing Roman army had already linked up with the Romans. He was now outnumbered. In the following battle at the Metaurus River in 207, Hasdrubal was outflanked and killed, while his army was defeated and scattered. Hannibal was now boxed in. He had no other choice but to retreat to a corner of Italy and hold out. The Romans still did not dare face him and his veteran army on the battlefield, but they used the time to secure control over Italy. Meanwhile, their campaigns in Spain were finding great success. After decisive victories, the young Scipio succeeded in expelling the Carthaginians from Spain in 206. The next target was Africa itself. In 204, under heavy pressure from Scipio, who would become a consul, the Romans organized their final push for Africa, assembling a massive invasion fleet and army. For the Romans, it was crucial that they solve the issue of their weak cavalry, and they did this by flipping the Numidians, former Carthaginian allies, to their side. Some Numidians followed the Romans, while others stayed with Carthage, but the cavalry would be much more even. The Romans landed in Africa. A battle was fought there in 203, and the Carthaginians lost decisively. Carthage, left without an army to defend its capital, recalled Hannibal from Italy. He would fight one last battle. In 202, Hannibal's army arrived in Africa. Commanding the other army was Scipio. Before the battle, Scipio and Hannibal had a conversation in private. It was the first time the two had met face to face, the young star and the old veteran. We don't know what they said, but they must have found each other fascinating. Perhaps they both regretted the fact that they had to be enemies. The Roman and Carthaginian armies met on a plain near Zama, a town in the vicinity of Carthage. Scipio's army was about 35,000 strong, while Hannibal had perhaps 40,000. A third of Hannibal's army was composed of new recruits, while the rest of his army were the veterans who had served him throughout his campaigns. Hannibal also had about 80 war elephants. The battle began as the two armies advanced on each other. Hannibal sent his elephants to disrupt the Roman lines, but the Romans had learned how to counter them. They blew loud horns to frighten the elephants, and then opened gaps in their lines to allow the elephants to run through them. The elephants passed harmlessly through the gaps, where they were killed from all directions by spears and projectiles. The infantry combat in the center turned in the Roman favor at first, as the front lines of recruits began to break, but the veteran infantry reinforced them, and the fighting became a stalemate. The decisive engagements took place on the flanks. Rome's Numidians routed Carthage's Numidians, driving the Carthaginian cavalry from the field, just as Hannibal had done so many times. Soon the Roman cavalry was attacking the Carthaginian lines from behind, and it was all over. Carthage finally surrendered after this battle. Hannibal, the invincible general, had been defeated on the battlefield. The peace agreement gave Rome all of Carthage's territories apart from a small area of land near Carthage itself. Rome was now the dominant power in the Mediterranean. Scipio went home and celebrated a triumph for his great victory. The Senate also awarded him a title, Africanus, for his final triumph in Africa. History thus remembers this great general as Scipio Africanus. Hannibal went home too. He took up a role in government in peacetime, assisting the economic recovery of Carthage. Chosen as the chief magistrate of the city, he fought corruption and reorganized state finances. After 7 years, Rome was so alarmed by Carthage's quick recovery that they ordered Hannibal into exile. Thus, Hannibal left his city. Hannibal eventually ended up in the court of Antiochus, king of the Seleucids, in Asia. He advised Antiochus in his wars against Rome, even commanding a fleet for him. But it was fruitless, for the Romans were simply too powerful. After several decisive defeats for Antiochus, Hannibal fled next to Bithynia, where he continued to fight wars against Rome's allies. Finally, the Romans decided that enough was enough. They sent a massive army into Bithynia in 182 with the sole objective of capturing Hannibal. After finding himself surrounded in a fortress by Roman soldiers, Hannibal poisoned himself, and he died. Reportedly, a letter written by Hannibal was found after his death. It says something like this: By dying, I relieve the Romans of a great burden, since it tries their patience too much to wait for an old man to die. Rome had a lot of enemies during its long history, but Hannibal was perhaps its greatest enemy ever. His tactical brilliance made him one of history's best generals, and the defeats Rome suffered at his hands would never be replicated. The Romans did defeat him in battle, but they never broke his spirit. His oath to his father as a little boy remained unbroken to the very end. He died in defiance. A romantic death. Many years after Zama, in a city 1,000 miles away from that bloody battlefield, the two great generals met once again. Hannibal and Scipio, perhaps the two greatest living generals in the world. Scipio was older and more experienced now than at their first meeting, while Hannibal was older and more jaded. The two must have had some fascinating conversations. At one point, Scipio asked Hannibal who the greatest general in history was. The answer came instantly: Alexander, the king of the Macedonians, because with a small force, he routed armies innumerable, and because he traversed the most distant regions of the world. Scipio then asked who was second. Pyrrhus. He had been the first to teach the art of constructing military camps. Besides, no one had chosen his ground or placed his troops more carefully. Scipio asked him who was third. Me, he responded. Scipio laughed. And what if you had beaten me? Hannibal thought for a second. Then I should place myself before Alexander, and before Pyrrhus, and before all other generals.